Let's look together, number 72, We Will Glorify. We will glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Lord Jehovah reigns in majesty. We will bow before his throne. We will worship him in righteousness. We will worship him alone. He is Lord of heaven, Lord of earth.
He is Lord of all
who live. He is Lord above the universe. All praise to him we give. Hallelujah to the King of Kings. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah to the Lord of Lords, who is the great.
Amen.
Sing hallelujah to the
King of Kings.
Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah to the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Amen, amen. Remain seated, remain standing, please. Let's remain standing. I'd like to invite your attention this morning to the fourth chapter of the Gospel as recorded by St. Luke, Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, and I'm again reading, again with verse 14. Then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and news of him went out through all the surrounding region. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified of all. So he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah, and when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." Then he closed the book and he gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." So all bore witness to him and marveled at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" And he said to them, "You will surely say this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself. Whatever we have heard done in Capernaum, do also here in your country.'" Then he said, "Surely I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. But I will tell you truly, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a great famine throughout all of the land. But to none of them was Elijah sent except to Zarephath in the region of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow. And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." Then all those in the synagogues, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath and rose up and thrust him out of the city, and they led him to the brow of the hill on which their city was built, that they might throw him down over the cliff. Then passing through the midst of them, he went his way. May God first bless me to his word and may be sanctifying our hearts. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we thank you again for the word of the Lord, for it is your word that brings light to our hearts, our minds, our souls, and our spirits, and it brings salvation to those who need to believe. We pray, Lord, that you'd open your word just today, that we might see the Lord Jesus Christ more clearly. Lord, you give us even greater directions to how we can serve and please you in the times in which we live. Open the heart of that person who never come to faith in Christ. They might cry, what must I do to be saved? In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I'd like to continue our thoughts this morning and wrap up this mini-series from this theme of Jesus' vision for ministry revisited. Jesus' vision for ministry revisited. And for the sake of those who have not been there, and for the sake of those of you who have been here, maybe have forgotten some of the things we shared, we will do a review. We opened up with a simple introductory statement, a quote from Helen Keller, when she said, is there anything worse than not having sight? Which she responded, yes, to have sight and no vision. The great intellectual Henry David Thoreau was once quoted as saying, it's not what you look at that matters, but it's what you see. What do you see? And so when we're looking at this working definition of vision, we said that vision is the ability to see. The Greek word from which vision is derived is optano, from which we get optometrist, and it simply means to see. Vision is to see. But in the biblical context, vision is the ability to see that which is not yet fully revealed, the ability to see that which is not yet obvious. And that's why the prophets in the Old Testament, the prophets referred to as the seers, which means they could see. They could see things, and they talked about what they saw. And the prophets would often see things and not even fully understood or understand what they were seeing. But they would talk about what they could see that was coming in the future. So vision is the ability to see that which is not yet obvious, that which has not yet been fully revealed, that which is not yet fully unveiled. And we say that hope has its origin in vision. For a working definition of hope, hope is a desire, an anticipation, and an expectation of a better future. Hope is a desire, an anticipation, and an expectation of a better future. So hope has its origin in vision. If I have a vision to believe that things can be better in the future, even though it's not yet obvious, it's not yet revealed, then that can give me hope in the present. Even though the present may be problematic, it may be difficult, it may be dysfunctional, it may be disheartening, but it's the vision that I can see that things can get better, and because I believe that things can get better, I'm going to exercise discipline and self-control today. I'm going to stay on the high ground of discipline and self-control because I want that future vision to be realized for me. And I don't want to throw away my future because I live recklessly or irresponsibly in the present. And so vision is important for the individual. It's important for a family. It's important for a church. It's important for an institution. Major corporations in this country, they spend countless hours and hundreds of thousands of dollars to craft out very finely fine-tuned and calibrated vision statements and mission statements to align with their core values, and then they seek to motivate all their employees to live, to chase the vision, to live out the mission, and to embrace the core values. And so Jesus had a vision of ministry. It was bold. It was regal. It was audacious. It was intimidating. And we see how big, how bold, and how audacious Jesus' vision for ministry was at the end of his life, after his death, burial, and resurrection. And when he says to the disciples, go into all the world and make disciples. He's speaking to a handful of people that were not well-educated in terms of advanced education, most of them. They had limited financial resources. They had no political clout, very little religious or social clout at that moment, but he cast this grand vision for them that he was going to give them a ministry to take the gospel to the whole world. It's a grand vision. It is a bold vision. It's an audacious vision that Jesus gave to the church. And we do not inflame the hearts of men and women with mediocre visions. If God is indeed in our midst, then God is going to do great and incredible things. And if we align with God, then God can do great, incredible, magnificent things in and through us for his own glory to advance his kingdom and bring many souls to himself. And so we have suggested in the 21st century, somewhere along the way, the church has kind of lost its spiritual way and has become accustomed and satisfied with the routine and the ritual of the church and with operating within some very well-defined parameters. We just can about predict what the preachers are going to say and predict what the people are going to do and predict almost everything the church is going to do. And so we've lost this sense of vision. We've lost a sense of mission. We've lost this sense of being involved in this great, grand, marvelous, and magnificent work of God. And I believe if we go back to the book, we can recapture the vision that the Lord has for the church. Now, our working text has been Proverbs 29:18. And most Christians are familiar with the text, Proverbs 29:18, which reads, "Where there is no vision, the people perish." And we try to get a more fuller interpretation of that text. It's really, that is a truncated interpretation of the real text in the literal Hebrew construction, because what it really says is where there is no prophetic word, where there is no prophetic word, the people cast off restraint. Where there's no prophetic word from God, the people cast off restraint. It is the prophetic word of God that reminds people who God is. It reminds people of who they are. It reminds the people of God whose they are and how we are to live our lives. It is the prophetic word of God that introduces people to the holiness of God, the transcendence of God, the magnificence of God. It's a prophetic word that arrests people to their responsibility to come to know this God and to live a life that is pleasing to him. So where there is no prophetic word, where people are not hearing a prophetic word about who God is, what God has done in the person of Christ, the salvation, the grace that God can bring, the anointing God can bring into people's lives to transform their lives from a dysfunctional mess into a beautiful mosaic for God's glory, where there's no prophetic word, then people will cast off restraint because they'll be driven by the tyranny of the urgent and the pull of the present and being inundated with all of these subliminal messages and not so subliminal messages, but open messages of go, fulfill all your desires, seek self-actualization. There's no use to exercise self-restraint. This is it. So get all you can and do all you can and fulfill all your desires. And in doing that, people can often find themselves totally derailed. And their lives can lead into some pretty deep, dark, and decadent places. So the absence of a prophetic word results in people often casting off restraints. The casting off restraints leads people into destructive lifestyles, and in essence, they self-destruct. That's the literal construct of that text. And so vision is important because vision helps us to continue to calibrate our lives and to keep our lives on that high plane of discipline and self-control. So let me kind of move kind of quickly to get to the text for this morning and give you a couple more comments about the backdrop of this text. As I've shared with you in recent weeks, it's always important that all of life is lived in a context. It's lived in a construct in time. And so there's often political, there's often economical, there's social, there's philosophical ideas that shape the context in which we live our lives. And so we don't get to just live inside the church. We get to come to the church building to worship. But our lives are lived in a context of a political environment, an economic environment, a social environment, and a philosophical ideas that are being postulated in the public square. And all these things shape the culture. The culture of any region, any state, any nation, it is shaped by the political, economical, social, and philosophical thoughts and ideas that are espoused. And it is even more so in a free society like ours, where there is the freedom of the press, and there's the freedom of thought, and there's the freedom of speech, and there's the freedom of expression. So all these ideas are circulating in the public arena at all times, and they're influencing how people think, and they're shaping people's value system. And more people's value systems are being shaped by a secular philosophical orientation, one that basically that does not recognize the Word of God as being the Word of God, any final authority for morality, one that does not recognize that God should be the center of one's life. And so we're living more and more in a secular society, and it's important that we as a church really kind of understand that. If you were to ask a lot of people where you go to work, if they believe the Bible is actually the Word of God, you'd be amazed at how many would say, well, I'm not sure, or I don't, or I question, have some good ideas, some good thoughts. I'm not really sure that we really should be trying to live our lives according to the Scripture. That is important. And we come to the Scripture, we got to understand the Bible was given through the men who God chose to use in a historical, philosophical, political, social, and religious construction, as is the case with the New Testament text. So we looked at Luke chapter 3 to get an understanding of that. The reason that Luke records the names of individuals like Tiberius Caesar, who's the 15th year of his reign, Pontius Pilate, who's the governor of Judea, Herod, who's the tetrarch of Galilee, Philip, his brother, who was also a tetrarch, is that Luke is writing to an individual who would have been familiar with these people that Luke mentions, and this person would have known how wicked, how decadent, how immoral these people were that were leading the nation, that were leading the state, and that were leading the regions. And these people's thoughts and ideas and philosophy were shaping the cultural values of the society where the masses of people live. And then he introduced Annas and Caiaphas, who were the religious leaders in Jerusalem, who also were corrupt, and was using their position, basically, to maintain their power base over the people under the authority of the Roman government. So Luke is setting a context in which John the Baptist emerges on the scene and a context in which Jesus will emerge on the scene. Are you following me? So when you read the Scripture closely, you find out that John got in trouble not over religion. John got in trouble over politics. He got in trouble over politics because his religious conviction forced him to make a statement to Herod, who was the tetrarch over the region where he lived in Galilee, and he told Herod, it's not right for you to have your brother Philip's wife. And because John brings this indictment against a politician, that's what cost John his head. Herod was not concerned about John as long as John was just preaching down by the Jordan River and the masses of people coming out being baptized. You read the text closely, you find that Herod actually liked John. He was intrigued by John. He would have John come to speak with him. But when John overstepped what Herod and what Herodias felt was his boundaries as a preacher, when he brings an indictment against a sitting religious official for his immorality, then John had to be silenced. And what will always happen is that always at some point become a point of irritation and agitation when the prophetic word is spoken in a free society, that there will be resistance to that prophetic word by those in political and economic power, because at some point the prophetic word will indict the established power for the oppression of the least of us among us. And that's what happened in John's case and in Jesus' case that we will see. So now we see, so John now is put in prison. Later John will be beheaded at the request of Herodias. And then Jesus now will start to fulfill the ministry that the Father had established to him since the foundation of the world. And with that as a backdrop, we come to Luke chapter 4. So John is in prison at this time, and John was not aware of his fate. See, John was a prophet, but the prophet is not omniscient. And so John thought Jesus was going to come, and he was going to set up his kingdom. When somebody arrested John, John wasn't even worried about it. He just knew that Jesus would come and bust him out because the kingdom was going to come, but that's not the case. There are times that God will instruct us to do something. We will think that one thing will happen, and what's going to actually happen is not the way it's going to play out. And very often things don't work out the way we think they should work out. And John the Baptist probably lived as closely to the will of God as any human being has ever lived that walked on the face of the planet in terms of trying to do exactly what God told him to do. He ends up in prison, disillusioned, confused, and have no idea why is it that Jesus won't get him out of prison. And he ends up being executed while he was in prison. He died confused, but still holding on to his faith. And that's the way life is sometimes. Life is complex. And a spiritual life is complex and is confusing at times. And we can do exactly what God instructs us to do to the best of our ability, but things still don't turn out the way we thought it would turn out, the way we thought it should turn out. And people will not always interpret our motives the way we intended for them to be interpreted. And that's a powerful lesson that John the Baptist's life teaches us. Do it all the best you can, the best way you can, and you still might exit out of here in a way that's less than glorious. And you still may not experience the joy that you thought you should have in life for a faithful life of service. That's the real Bible. But after a while and by, God always rewards. And John the Baptist will be rewarded for his faithfulness. When Luke chapter 4, Luke now brings Jesus onto the scene. Jesus now has been tempted. He's been baptized. He's been in the wilderness, tempted for 48 days. And he returns back to the hometown where he had been raised in Nazareth of Galilee, a northern province in Israel. And so verse 16 says he came to Nazareth as had been his custom. He goes to the synagogue. It's on the Sabbath day. It's his time to read the sacred text. He's handed the scroll with the book of Isaiah. He stands up and reads that Isaiah 61 messianic passage. He only reads a portion of the passage from Isaiah 61. And then in verse 20, he says he then closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And all the eyes who were in the synagogue were fixed on him and began to say to them, today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. Let's stop right there. So in reading this messianic passage from Isaiah chapter 61, Jesus casts in an incredible and amazing economy of words his vision for ministry for the next 3.5 years. He lays down the template. He lays down the parameters which he will discharge his ministry for the next 3.5 years. And if you read the rest of the gospel records from here forward, you'll find that he operated within this template that he lays down in Luke chapter 4. So the first thing he does is that he introduced the person that's inspiring his vision. He says, the Spirit of the Lord that is upon me. So he introduced the person inspiring the vision as the Spirit of God. Zechariah talks about not by power nor by might, but by my Spirit, said the Lord God of hosts. It is the ministry of the Holy Spirit that we receive when we put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ that gives us the capacity now to embrace, to understand the vision of ministry that Jesus has for the church and the vision of ministry that Jesus has for each and every one of us. So he says the person inspiring his vision is the Spirit of the Lord. Secondly, he delineates the power that he has to accomplish the vision. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me. It is the anointing, and we describe the anointing as the supernatural enablement of God that enables us to accomplish the will of God that we otherwise would not be able to do. It is the anointing that comes with the Spirit of the Lord that gives us the ability to accomplish things for God's glory. It is one thing for us to sing a song that people stand up and applaud and give a standing ovation to. It's another thing to sing a song that will minister to someone's heart to where they sense the presence of God to bring comfort, to bring encouragement, to bring relief, to bring conviction, whatever it might be. So Jesus says the person of the Spirit, the power is the anointing. And we saw from the Old Testament how that when the kings were going to take their throne, or the prophets or the priests were assuming the roles, that they would be ceremonially anointed. They would pour oil upon their heads and allow it to run down. And that oil recognized the Spirit of God bringing the anointing that will enable that person to do the will of God the way way that God wanted it done. The third thing he does, he establishes the priority of the vision, the person, the Spirit of the Lord, the power of the anointing. The priority is preaching. The priority is the caruso. It is the declaration. It is the heralding of the word of the Lord. And we use a simple illustration about how in antiquity, before there was a printing press, before potentates had called press conferences, before there was a media, the king or the queen would have a herald. And they would call the herald to come to them, and they would whisper in the herald's ear the message that they wanted disseminated to the masses. The herald would then go out normally and mount upon his horse and ride into the public square and declare, hear ye, thus saith the king. So the illustration here, Jesus saying, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me to preach that I received the word, in this case from the Father, has been whispered into my ear, and now it's my responsibility to go out and herald the gospel of the kingdom. And so that becomes our primary responsibility as the church. Our primary responsibility as individual Christians is to be heralders of the sacred secrets. It's to tell the story about Jesus Christ. That is the priority of the vision of Christ. It is the priority of the church. And then lastly, he delineates the people that are targeted by the vision. And this, more than anything, would have been surprising to his hearers. The fact that the Spirit of the Lord was upon him, it wouldn't have surprised them. He'd have been anointed. That wouldn't have surprised them. To preach, that wouldn't have surprised them, because that was all a part of the Jewish religious system. The Spirit, the anointing, the prophetic word, that was all anchored as a part of the Jewish Hebrew religious tradition. But by this time, Judaism had become corrupted. It had become tainted. And this whole idea that they were a community, and that as a community, they were responsible for the least that were among them. And the Jewish religion system now, it was corrupted. The chief priests, the scribes, and the Sadducees basically were the ruling class in Israel, even though the whole nation was an occupied territory by the Roman government. But the Roman government was so vast, it was so large, the Roman government had to use existing apparatuses to keep all the different people groups under control. And so if a people group was religious, and if that religious system served the ends of the Roman government to help keep the people under control, they would allow them to keep their religion as long as they paid their taxes, as long as they did not promote insurrection against the Roman government, as long as the people remained docile and under control. And that's what they did in Israel. So they cut a deal. They cut a deal basically with the Sanhedrin, the ruling class of men. They cut a deal with them, keep the people under control, and you can continue to use your religious system for your religious ends and for your commercial ends. And so what had happened is Judaism now was a quasi-spiritual, religious, political, economic system. The power rested with the high priest who ruled, was over the Sanhedrin. And so now you got a group that's supposed to be spiritual and leading the people spiritually, but basically become the extension of the oppressive hand of the Roman government. And their main job for themselves is to maintain control of the masses of people. And they were very, very rich. They were extremely affluent because they had created a religious system of oppression. They had this temple which was absolutely immaculate, was a palace that was palatial. It had every amenity. They were able to tax the people to support themselves and to support the maintenance of the temple. They had the Jewish feast, which was like a multifest on steroids, where as much as 1 million-plus people would come back to Jerusalem. And when they came back to Jerusalem, they turned the temple into a bazaar, into a giant flea market. And so people could buy just about anything you could imagine inside the temple. They charged them exorbitant rates to exchange their money because they made them pay their tithe and the currency they wanted. They made them purchase the sacrifices from the temple, and so to meet their requirement. And they turned this thing into a religious enterprise. and they were extremely wealthy and affluent at the expenses of the masses of the working poor of Jews that were in Israel at the time. And that's what Jesus steps into. Jesus steps into something that's not just a case of political corruption. It's not just economic exploitation. It's not just religious corruption. It's not just social decline. It's all of it. It's all of it put together. And now it has its epicenter in Jerusalem, its epicenter in the temple, and the religious leaders are running the show. So from the day Jesus steps on the scene, he's on a collision course. And that's why Luke lists in Luke chapter 3, Annas and Caiaphas as being the high priest, because they would be his chief protagonists. It wouldn't be Tiberius Caesar, who was in Rome. It wouldn't even be Herod, who was the governor. Jesus' number one enemy would be Annas and Caiaphas, the Sanhedrin, the elders, the rulers of the Jewish religious system, because they were the ones that was the closest to the people, and they were the ones responsible for the most oppression and the most suppression of the people. Are you following? It's important we understand what the Bible really has to say, because we rush through it and we don't understand all of these political, socioeconomic, and religious nuances that's happening in the text. And it wasn't religion that got John the Baptist killed, and it wasn't religion that got Jesus executed. It wasn't religion at all. It was politics and economics. It was politics and economics. The fact that the political power brokers and the economic power brokers saw their position being challenged by Jesus because he was informing and educating the people in ways that they had not been enlightened before, and they knew that they were being basically unclothed before the masses of people, and that's why the religious leaders wanted Jesus to go at any cost. So now, what does Jesus do? What did he do? What does he do? Very early in his ministry, he basically sends a shot over the bow that said, this is not going to be business as usual. And so he does that in the people that he targets for his vision in Luke 4. We saw them last time. We will see them again before we close. Look at what he says. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Poor that he's referring to, it's not even the working poor. It is the destitute poor. It is the widows. It is the physically incapacitated. It is the orphans. It's the people that sit on the roadside having to beg because they had no access to any type of economic means at all. To the most destitute of the poor, that's who I'm targeting. It's going to be a bottom up. It's not going to be trickle down spiritual economics. I'm starting at the bottom, and we're going to work our way up to poor. Secondly, preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to heal the brokenhearted, the crushed, those who have been spiritually crushed. And you know who some of these people are. I know who some of these people are. I like to think of them often as the children who have been crushed in our child foster care system, in our juvenile justice system. Spirits have been crushed. Hundreds of women and children primarily who are the victims of domestic violence, or children, the victims of child abuse and neglect. It crushes the spirit. It crushes the spirit. That's why Jesus says, better for a man than a millstone be hung around his neck and he be drowned into the depth of the sea than have to face judgment for offending a child. Because when you offend a child, you can ruin the rest of their life. And not only you ruin the rest of their life, you can ruin the lives of people they come in contact with, whose life they ruin. He says, I come to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, to those who are held hostage. And we will see immediately in Luke chapter 31. The first thing after this particular encounter that Jesus does, he goes and heals a man that has been demon-possessed by a multitude of demons. He's captive. He is held captive by these demons. And so the people that are held captive, whether the spiritual captivity is a result of demonic possession, whether it's the captivity to an addiction, Jesus says, I came to deliver those that are captive. The recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, who have been oppressed. And the Jewish people, they have been oppressed. And the greatest oppression, yes, there was oppression coming from Rome, but the greatest oppression among the common people is coming from their own religious leaders and the system they had created to keep this caste system in existence so that they could benefit at the expense of the people to preach acceptable year of the Lord. So he targets the poor, the brokenhearted, the crushed in spirit, the captive, the bound, the blind, the oppressed or bruised as the targets for his ministry. That doesn't mean that middle-class people and upper-middle-class people and rich people can't be saved. It doesn't mean there's not a place for them in the kingdom. It means the exact opposite. There's always a place for everybody, but Jesus makes it clear, I'm targeting those who otherwise would be left out. And when you watch him through the scripture, you'll find that wealthy people are attracted to Jesus because he has a different vision. He has an inclusive vision. A vision that truly says that every person is equal in the eyes of God, and that God is an equal opportunity savior, and that God can save people from every rung of the socioeconomic ladder. And so people are attracted that they will be a part of doing something significant and something meaningful and something impactful, because no street, no city, no town, no nation is any stronger than its most marginalized people. Are y'all listening to me? Well, y'all think I'm just talking, but when I'm going away from here, some of y'all going to go back and listen to some of the things I said and say, look, that bald-headed boy knew a little bit of something about something. Now all the statistics are catching up. Big article in the paper, Huffington Post, first place I saw it, then it appears in the Charleston newspaper. They picked up on it. I hope you saw it. In the United States of America, listen to this now, this is not watched exaggerated, in the United States of America, almost 50% of all black men between the age of 18 to 23 will be arrested, 50%. And let me serve notice, almost 40% of all Caucasian will be arrested. So what are we doing? Because we no longer have a vision for these young folks. We don't need 3.5 million people in the military like we needed in 1968 at the height of the Vietnam conflict. 3.5 million people in the United States military back in 1968. Now we only got 1.5 million. We got 2 million people less in the military today than we had in 1968. Yet we got 80 million more people in the country. We don't need these young men now to go out and fight these wars in these foreign theaters because we'll just send drones and we'll drop bombs from the sky. We don't need them. We don't need them to drive the economy because we don't need them to mine coal out of the coal mine. When I was a boy, there was 100,000 coal miners in the coal mines in West Virginia, 100,000. And now in West Virginia, we mine more coal than ever in history. I think the third per capita in the world is mined in West Virginia with 20,000. So now there's no longer need for this young, strong labor, so we create a prison industrial complex. So now we're putting thousands of young people through the prison system, labeling them convicted felons if they get convicted, and they basically are done for the most part of any meaningful opportunity in this country. It's a crisis. The only thing that makes sense in this country is to try to put people to work. We got roads that need to be built. Over half the bridges in this state, more than half, I'm a civil engineer, y'all, design bridges. More than half of the bridges in this state basically are defective, and they need to be repaired. A major study was done by the Western Department of Transportation. They came back at what needs to happen to the interstate highway system, all our major roadways who are in great need of repair. We need to put these people to work. We need to put them to work. We need public works program to build the infrastructure. The city of Charleston's sewer system is almost 100 years old, maybe over 100 years of age. It is in total disrepair. It's a combination storm sanitary system going into one system, which is totally antiquated. It needs to be repaired. We need a job program. And anybody got any sense would understand that is a zero-sum game if we keep arresting and incarcerating our young people, because they're going to be around for a long time. And there's one thing they do on their way to prison, back from prison. There's one thing they do. They make babies. They make babies, sometime between before arrested, after coming back, And their children are left that we've got to raise. So this is not a political matter. This is a matter that's in the best interest of the society. We cannot continue to criminalize a generation of young people. They have too long to live. So Jesus targets the most marginalized. Seven more minutes, now I'll be through. So he finishes this sermon. He closed the book, gave it back to the attendant, and he sat down. And y'all wish y'all had a pastor like that, who just read the text and then sat down. But see, their custom was, after the preacher read the text, he would sit down and then he would talk about it. They would ask him questions about it. They would interpret the text. So he wasn't done yet. So he takes his seat. Luke chapter 4, verse 20. And then he starts to elaborate on the text. And he gives them a prophetic word, a prophetic prediction of the people's response to his sermon. A prophetic prediction. Look at verse 21. And he began to say, today the scriptures fulfilled in your hearing. So all bore witness to him and marveled at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, isn't this Joseph's boy? He would have been fine if he would have stopped right there. But he didn't. And he said to them, you will surely say this proverb. Now he gives a prophetic prediction of how they're going to respond to his vision, to his ministry, and to his work. You will surely say, physician, heal yourself. And whatever you have heard done in Capernaum, whatever we've heard done in Capernaum, do also here in your own country. Show us some of the tricks that you showed them over in Capernaum. Do some of the spiritual miracles you performed in Capernaum. The problem was, in Capernaum, the people had faith. And he responds to people's faith to believe. But in his own hometown, they had no faith. They say, this is just Joseph's boy. We've known him since he was a snotty-nosed kid running around his father's carpenter shop. There's nothing special about him. Verse 24. And he said, assuredly, I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. And in John 4:44, and in Mark 6, they add a footnote. Not only is he not accepted in his country, he's not accepted among his own kin, and he's not accepted in his own house. So Jesus is saying to them, I'm prophetically predicting you're going to reject me before you rejected me. Because the prophet does not have acceptance in his own country, in his own, among his own kin, in his own house. But then he prophesies against them again. This is what got him really in trouble. But I tell you truly, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heavens were shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a great famine throughout all of the land. But to none of them was Elijah sent except to Zarephath, in the region of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow. And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha, the prophet. And none of them was cleansed except Naaman, the Syrian. Now, what was all that about? What was all that about? He now prophetically indicts them by going back in antiquity. And he says, in the days of Elijah the great prophet, when he prayed to God against the dynamic duel of Ahab and Jezebel, that God would show that he indeed was God, and God heard his cry, and God shut up the heavens, and shellac formed over the heavens, and for the space of 42 months, it didn't rain. And everything was dry, and everything was parched, and there was a total famine in the land. And he says there were starving people everywhere. And there were widow women struggling, starving all over Israel. But God didn't visit one of them. God didn't visit one of them. God left the nation of Israel, went over into another region, and there he found a widow woman, and that's who he sent Elijah to. And there were many lepers in Israel in the day of Elijah the prophet. Lepers are the most hideous of all diseases. It was the AIDS, the cancer of that hour. And there were lepers all over Israel. He says, but God didn't heal not one of them in the days of Elijah. What God did, he went over and healed a Gentile. Now, this was a problem as a big of an indictment that he would bring against them, because what he was saying to them is that your spiritual lineage, what you pride yourself in, does not get you any brownie points with God. It is a broken spirit as a contrite heart. That is what God will not despise. And God has already shown the nation of Israel during the days of Elisha and Elijah that they get no special treatment from him if they won't turn to him and embrace his vision and do his will. And God will select people that you ordinarily would not think could be a part of God's program. That's what this was about. And Jesus was predicting that God will lead the nation of Israel, and God will select a bunch of nobodies to bring them into his kingdom to advance his agenda when the somebodies think that they are so superior to the nobodies. Oh, y'all listen to me. He is saying to these proud Jewish people in their synagogue in Nazareth of Galilee, if you think just because you are a Jew, that's going to guarantee that God can never depart from working in your midst. You think you're going to hold God hostage by your tradition and by your religion? You think that God can only work in the context and construct of how you think he's supposed to work? God will operate totally outside of your system and leave you with the system. And he'll be on the outside of it. And he'll write Ichabod. And he says he's done it. He left the nation to show his power when he goes to Sidon and to Zarephath. This was a strong indictment. He was saying, y'all in spiritual trouble. You don't even know it. You're in deep spiritual trouble, and you don't even realize the depth of your spiritual trouble, that you're caught in a vortex, you're caught in a whirlpool that is spinning and you're going down with it, holding on to a religious system and tradition that is void of the power of God. They were in synagogue. They went every week. It was a custom. It was a tradition. But they had lost the vision of what it meant to be the people of God. Now, what's interesting here is Jesus first preaches this sermon in one of the most despised towns of Israel, Nazareth of Galilee. The Jews from the south despised the Nazarenes. As a fact, Nathanael said, nothing good can come out of Nazareth. So he preaches this sermon to cast this vision in one of the most despised towns in the country. And what do they do? If this thing was going to take hold anywhere, you thought it would take hold in Nazareth of Galilee. Look at verse 29. Then all those in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. Their response was anger. His audacity to say that God is not bound to work within the construct of our religion and our system. His audacity to say that God will move outside of what we have created for God to work in, and that God will go and work in some other people other than us. And they were filled with wrath. You see, religion without a relationship with Jesus Christ, religion without the Spirit of the Lord and the anointing, religion without the spiritual intelligence that God brings, it's the most dangerous thing in the world. There have been more people killed in the name of religion, more slaughters in the name of religion, more slaughters in the name of Christianity than maybe any other religion. Bible in hand, sword and gun in the other hand. Slaughtering people in the name of religion that is not truly informed by the prophetic word and not really trying to discharge the vision that God himself has articulated through Jesus Christ. So in wrapping this up, the Bible says, verse 29, and they rose up and they thrust him out They threw him out of his hometown where he had been since he was a little boy. They threw him out of town. They drove him to the end of the city, and they drove him to a cliff. They tried to assassinate him because he preached this one sermon. They led him to the brow of the hill, which the city was built, that they might throw him down over the cliff. And sometime miraculously, he was able to just kind of navigate his way through them. And he leaves Nazareth of Galilee, and he moves to Capernaum. He only comes back one more time. He only comes back to Nazareth one more time in the rest of his ministry. Because they rejected the prophetic word. They rejected his ministry. And his prophecy was fulfilled. That those whom it saw, as the scripture refers to them, those who sat in great darkness, the people of Nazareth of Galilee, who saw the great light, and the great light was in their midst, and they rejected the great light, and they were left to their darkness. Well, that's Jesus' vision of ministry. And what his vision of ministry will always do, it will attract attention, and it will result in some tension. Some tension. And it will often, not often, it will always face opposition. Because Jesus' vision of ministry is about calling people to repentance, but it's also about calling people to justice and fairness. And so when the prophetic word of justice and fairness is articulated, it automatically will get resistance. And as we move through the text, and we've looked at these in previous times, we begin to realize that that is what alarmed the Jewish religious leaders. That they realized that the message that he was preaching was a challenge to their system of control, of exploitation, and of oppression of the people. And that's what they feared. And we will see in coming weeks how they say, well, he just has to go. If he doesn't go, we're going to lose our position. It's not about the truth. It's not about God's kingdom. It's not about what's right. It's about preserving and maintaining our position. And that's when they finally concluded that he must go. And they, in essence, entered into a contract that Jesus would be killed. And this was not done by the Roman government. This was not done by Herod or Philip. This was done by Annas and Caiaphas, the religious leaders in Israel. It was their clandestine plan for political and economic reasons, not religious, that led to the murder of Jesus of Nazareth. So as we try to really just to find and understand Jesus' vision of ministry, and then we have to grope and grapple and wrestle with it, what does it mean for us in the 21st century? What is our role? How do we discharge his vision for ministry in the political, economic, social, religious, spiritual context in which we find ourselves? And that's always the challenge for the church. That's always a challenge for the church, to find its way in its time in which it exists, as to how it aligns itself with Jesus' visions of ministry, so the Spirit of the Lord can be upon it and anoint it to preach the gospel in a way that brings consequence and leads to the salvation of many. I'm out of my time. I thank you for yours. Let's pray together, shall we?